some new service today. Those who came in earlier, back now. It is, of course, Mother's Day. I hope nobody forgot it. It has been well publicised, I think, around to try and get us to buy presents, etc. But it is important, isn't it? And I thought we'd start today with reminding ourselves that this is a day to give thanks for our mothers and all their loving care for us. Some here today have, of course, lost their mums due to old age and death, but we still remember them and the impact they had and have on our lives and on the values that we have. Some of us were privileged to have a Christian mother who taught us from our early years about the Lord Jesus. Well, on this one day in the year, we give thanks for them. You remember from the scriptures that Jesus showed great love for his mother, and even while he was in extreme pain on the cross, he looked down and saw his mother watching. And in spite of the fact it must have been very difficult to speak, he spoke to John, the disciple next to her, and said to John, basically, John, this is your mother, mother, this is your son. Basically asking John to take care of his mother. I started to think a little bit last night about my own mother. She'd have been 110 if we'd been here today. She brought up a family during wartime, and because of this, she was always a very frugal person. She was known frequently in the family and beyond as Nitty Nora, because she spent every moment of her life, I think, when she was not doing anything else and cooking for us, as knitting. She used to make me at least one sweater and jumper every single year. And when she went to be with the Lord, I think I had about 20 of these left. I've just about worn them right now. And I don't miss getting my new ones every year. But it was interesting, when she got to 80 years old, just a bit more, with a bit of arthritis, as you do at that age, she used to walk from her home down into town and back, which is about a 3-mile round trip. Why did she do that? Well, because it would have cost her a few pence to go on the bus. And she was always a person that taught me, if you take care of the pennies, the pounds will take care of themselves. You've probably heard that expression. But I remember particularly about my mum, in the summer holidays, my dad, in those days, got about 8 or 9 days holiday in the year, that was all. And she would drive my brother and myself in an old Ford 8 to the seaside, which is about 24 miles from where we lived in Norfolk. And I can remember vividly on one occasion my brother got quite excited. He told her, look, look, she's actually got to 30 miles an hour in the car. These are the memories that we have, aren't they, of people that have been dear to us. You've all got your own memories, and it's important, isn't it, that we all acknowledge the fact of how much our mums meant to us and how much they do for us, in some cases how much they're still doing for us. And let's begin then with a prayer on this Mother's Day. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, when the Lord Jesus was here on earth, he blessed children and families. And today we thank you for our mothers, for their kindness and sacrifices they made for us. We do pray that today children, wherever they are, will learn to appreciate their mums, and as far as they can be, honour them and be obedient to them. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. First hymn, 790. I think aptly describes our Lord Jesus Christ, but it's asking us to be still, my soul, the Lord is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. It's a lovely hymn and a tune. It's from Finlandia. And I think most of you will know it well. Let's sing this together. Consider the second part of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and in that chapter it talks about if you're in Christ you are a new creation, the old has gone, the new has come, among other things in that passage. We should be looking at on Wednesday. Saturday is our members meeting. If you can arrive about between 9:15 and 9:30, a little breakfast together. If you're not as yet a member of the church, we do have a membership here, and you'd like to become a member so that you can play a full part in all the activities of the church and the decisions it makes, please have a word with me afterwards and we can arrange for that. reminding on the 2nd of April, it's a family service, when we're going to look for the children at kind of a diary of the last week of the life of Jesus. And Good Friday, we have a service in the afternoon, which is a reading and hymns and songs related to the events of Good Friday, the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ. Just to remind you, next Sunday, please change your clocks, otherwise you may arrive as we just completed the service. They're going to be changed, we get an hour less in bed. That may or may not be a good thing. Just mention also, of course, this week is on Tuesday, Phil is due to go and have his operation. So far, so good. Though we get warning of any delay, let's keep praying for that, and we will do a bit later on in our time of prayer. I'm going to do the first reading now, which is from Mark chapter 14, verses 1 to 11. Mark 14, 1 to 11. And in this passage, as well as some very sad news at the beginning, there's a lovely incident in the life of Jesus. Now the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were only 2 days away, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were scheming to arrest Jesus secretly and kill him. But not during the festival, they said, or the people may riot. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. Some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, "Why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages, and the money given to the poor." And they rebuked her harshly. "Leave her alone," said Jesus. "Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want, but you will not always have me." She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priests to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted to hear this and promised to give him money. So he watched for an opportunity to hand him up. Our next hymn or song is on the screen. And the words and the title are important, aren't they? Jesus Christ, my living hope. We're going to join in singing this lovely song.
Shadows of
that we as Christians have a living hope. In the last few weeks we've been at a couple of different funerals. And it's wonderful when you go to a Christian's funeral because it's filled with hope. Because the folks there know that this person has just passed through death into the presence of the Lord. We're going to have a time of prayer now. And among our prayers, we're obviously going to pray for Mike and Betty. Many of you will perhaps have had the updates from them during the course of this week, but things have been very, very difficult for both of them. So let's come before the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, loving Heavenly Father, we come into your presence to worship you, to pray to you, knowing that we have access into your most holy presence. What a privilege it is, Lord, that we can come into your presence with our prayers and petitions. We have been reminded in our last song of the hope that we have in Jesus. We don't any longer need to fear death, for knowing that is not the end. Knowing as Christian people, we will pass through death into your wonderful presence. As we come before you this morning, Lord, we would thank you for all our material blessings. We thank you, Lord, for our homes, our families, especially for our mothers on this day. We thank you, Lord, for our food, our clothes, the comforts of this life that you have bestowed upon us. We are so grateful that you have given us so much. And we pray that with what you've given us, we may be generous to those that don't have all these privileges. We pray this morning for those, Lord, who are mourning the loss of loved ones, for those who are ill, for those who are in hospital. And we especially bring before you Betty and Mike. You know the problems that there have been this week, that she went to an operation and was taken back. They didn't do it. But she couldn't. She's been not able to keep any food down. We realise, Lord, that she's very, very poorly. And Mike is very upset too about the way she's been looked after in the hospital. We do pray, Lord, that you will draw near to them today. We pray, Lord, that they will know your presence with them. And they will know that you are with them each step of the way. Likewise, we pray for Phil that the operation will go ahead and be successful for him next Tuesday. We will again remember Andrew and Judy. We are gathering now due to move on the 30th of this month. We do pray for them as they get ready for that move. Pray that you will lead them to a church that will be helpful for them, which is not too far from where they will be living. And we continue to pray that you will guide us as a group of your people in this church to make wise and right decisions in accordance with your will. So bless us now, and we give you thanks again and praise and worship in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to read the second part of the reading this morning, which is particularly important as later we shall be meeting around the Lord's table. It's from verse 12 up to verse 26. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Why do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him." Say to the owner of the house he enters, The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there. The disciples left, went into the city and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at the table eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They were saddened, and one by one they said to him, "Surely you don't mean me." "It's one of the 12," he replied, "one who dips bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it's written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." While they were eating, Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take it, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them. They all drank from it. "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. "Truly I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." When they sang a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. May God bless to us the portions of his word that we have read. Our next hymn is 842, if you're actually using a hymn book to make it easier to see. 842, which was a hymn written by Martin Luther based on Psalm 130. And it's very important for us sometimes, isn't it, to know that when we're in deep distress, what should we do? We should cry to the Lord for "From deep distress I cry to thee, Lord, hear me, I implore thee, bend down thy gracious ear to me, regard my prayer before thee." Let's sing this lovely hymn from Martin Luther.
Faithful shepherd, he
study of Mark's Gospel, we have reached the last Wednesday and Thursday of the life of the Lord Jesus. The beginning of our chapter today, we learn that there was a plot afoot to arrest and kill Jesus. The great feast was about to begin, the Passover feast. A feast where thousands, in fact, something in the region of 2 million Jewish people went and flocked to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. And at that point, the chief priests and the teachers of the law, the Sanhedrin, were looking for a sly way to arrest Jesus and kill him. It needed to be secretive and quick, and all over before the great feast. They had agreed not publicly to arrest him during the feast, as the people, it tells us in Mark 14, would have rioted. There were so many of Jesus' followers among their group in Jerusalem. If that happened, well, they knew what would happen. The Roman garrison, which was supplemented by large numbers of troops during the festival, would have cracked down hard on any riot, and that would have led to much bloodshed. And that the decision they made was on the Wednesday of the last week of Jesus' life. They were plotting to a way to arrest and kill Jesus. So it's a rather sad and dismal start to that chapter. And then suddenly we get a complete opposite. We get this act of loving devotion towards Jesus. A wonderful act of love and devotion amid all the plotting and venom against Jesus by the religious leaders. Jesus was staying, it tells us, overnight during this week at Bethany, a village about 2 miles outside the city. And verse 3 tells us that he and his disciples were reclining at table in the home of a man called Simon the leper. It's probably a former leper, because if he was still suffering from leprosy, he would not have been allowed in a normal home. But if we compare this account with the one recorded by John in his gospel, it appears this was the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Simon, who was probably an older person, maybe related to them, maybe he was the owner of the home, we don't know. But we do know that the Lord loved this family a great deal. Their formal dining was to recline at table. We tend to sit down at table, eat our food and get out quick. They used to lay down and take hours on their formal meals. We're told by Mark a woman came in. Mark doesn't mention the name of this woman, but John says it was Mary. Came in with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume made from pure nard. It certainly was expensive. John names the woman as Mary, Martha's sister, and Lazarus' sister. We're told that she broke the jar and poured the perfume on Jesus' head lavishly. This was a loving act of devotion, to show her love for the Lord, and was, I suppose, the one bright moment during these dreadful, traumatic days before Jesus would be crucified on the Friday. What was the reaction to this loving devotion? Well, the first reaction was a stinging criticism. You always get people criticized when they don't like something, or they think they know better. Some were present, it says, were indignant It's a very strong word. Criticised her actions. And in fact, the original language this was written in, it says they murmured and snorted at her. What a waste of perfume. It could have been sold for a year's wage, 300 denarii, and the money given to the poor. They rebuked her harshly. But what was the response of Jesus? So different, wasn't it? Leave her alone. Why are you bothering her? She's done a beautiful thing to me. Jesus so appreciated this loving gesture. He said to the people who were complaining about what could be done for the poor, he says, well, you've got the poor and you'll always have them with you. You can help them whenever you want. But you'll not always have me. In fact, this was Thursday. Friday, he was on the cross, being put to death. Jesus knew what would happen to him. And he says this, she did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. And the verse 9, which I think is a lovely verse in Mark 14, a wonderful commendation to the love and devotion of this lady. He said, I tell you the truth, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will be told in memory of her. She wouldn't have expected anything like that. But even today, as people read the scriptures, this story has been retold and told again, as we are this morning. So what a loving devotion she showed towards Jesus in the last few hours or days of his life. But there's a contrast here. After such a loving act, verse 10 turns to the opposite. Because it tells us Judas Iscariot decided to act against Jesus. Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priest to betray Jesus to them. We're told that Judas Iscariot was the one who held the purse. That was the money that disciples and Jesus and people used to get their daily food, I suppose. But from what we read in the scriptures, it was evident that he was not too honest. Now he went to the chief priest with an offer to betray Jesus to them, where they could secretly and quickly arrest him and put him on trial. What was their reaction? They were delighted. Wow, we've got someone who can really listen to him at the moment when he's alone, quiet, and we can quickly arrest him, get him put on trial and kill him. So delighted were they, promised to give him money. 30 pieces of silver. Do you remember what the perfume cost? 300. So just a tenth of that they were offering him, about 1 month's wage. And in fact, that 30 pieces of silver was known in Exodus as the blood price of a servant or a slave. And so what did then Judas do? Well, he was set about finding an opportunity where Jesus could easily, quietly be arrested. So what a contrast in this first part of the chapter. Love and devotion, hatred and betrayal. We still don't see the same contrast today. Love and devotion among Christian folks. And that love and devotion will be shown as we take part in communion later. But there's the opposite, isn't there? There's still those who hate and spit venom about Jesus, about God, and about there even being a Jesus or God. You're going to stop. stop at that point and we're going to sing. We're going to sing 437. There are two hymns that are going to lead us into our communion today. We'll sing this one first before we look at the second part of the passage. 437, he gave his life in selfless love, for sinful man he came. He had no stain of sin himself, but bore our guilt and shame. Thank you.